In the early 80s, Dick took a year off to work on this novel that his father had started, and it was finally completed in the mid-90s, and that's where we are tonight. My interest is in family history, and so that's what led to this whole shindig tonight, I guess we can call it. I had done some research on a local family who was of Polish origin, so when I saw the book and recognized the name of Jadwiga, that it was Polish, I picked up the book and thought it was a very, very nicely written story about a person's ancestors coming over from Poland and settling in the Dunkirk area. So I had been in contact with Dick, and after a couple years, he said he was going to be in this area, so I asked him to come along. So with that, from Dunkirk by way of Ann Arbor, Michigan, and Roosevelt Island, New York City, here's Dick Lutz.
Great fun to be back home in Western New York. Thank you all for coming. It's a great turnout. I appreciate that. We're going to do three readings from Jadwiga's Crossing, and two of them are slightly long and one of them is short. So I'll ask you to bear with me through the long ones, and I think they'll give you a strong flavor of what Jadwiga's Crossing is all about. It is actually a time machine. A time machine you can hold in your hand and read, and it takes us back to 1869. And for many years, the nation of Poland has not existed on any map. It was divided by the Congress of Vienna and put into the care or the plunder of three nations, Russia, Austria, and Prussia, which was Germany, of course. And though they are spoils of, Poland is spoils of war for them. Things are being taken from the Polish people, including their land. Bismarck has instituted a campaign of Kulturkampf, or culture war, in an attempt to effectively obliterate Polishness, or the Polish language and any memory of being Polish. And in the Prussian sector, the people resist. They choose to keep their Polish culture alive. And so it's in this setting that we encounter our story. Across centuries of seasons, there have been willows greening for the Polish spring on the Baltic shore at Gdynia. Invaders and occupiers have come, and in time, they have gone. The glowing beach has sometimes ebbed with a shift of wave or current, or swelled with a new deposit of sand. Even the dunes have grown or waned in their time. But there have always been the willows, clinging to life through summer storm and winter freeze. It is as though the willows have studied the ways of the fishing people, and have learned how to pass through storms and how to judge the bending required when invader or occupier appears. That's the setting. Invaders and occupiers have appeared over the years, and in this setting we're about to meet a beautiful young Polish girl who's just come of age, and she is now ready for marriage. But she has little interest in the boys in her neighborhood, in this fishing community. She is fired, in fact, by a dream given to her by her late mother, a dream of emigrating to America. She finds herself a husband at a mustering out parade where Polish conscripts are separated from Bismarck's army. She brings him home to meet her father and her brothers, two brothers, but because he arrives wearing the uniform in which he was mustered out, he has a problem with Jadwiga's father, because Jadwiga's father does not at all approve of this business of wearing a German uniform. So our time machine has now taken us to chapter 4, where there is a confrontation between Paul, the soldier, and Jadwiga's father. On Wednesday, Paul met all of Jadwiga's friends and many of their parents up and down the beach. Apart from the stories of his arrival in a blue uniform and his service to the Germans, he was well accepted among the fishing people. Only Vladek and Zdenek, the fishing helpers, were a sullen exception. With Jadwiga's young friends, there were playful wrestling matches and foot races at the edge of the water. Some of the girls even flirted with him when Jadwiga wasn't looking. Yet, the matter of the blue uniform and Paul's supposed Prussian leanings hung unresolved like a discarded fishnet gone stiff in the sun. It did not help when that afternoon Paul was teaching young boys to march, and he was using German words of command, and he was heard by Jadwiga's father. And at supper, it was plain that Jadwiga and her father had been talking about Paul and his military service. When she spoke to her father, it was a continuation. "In America, Papa, it won't matter what language one speaks if one learns the American language too." Getting no response, she added more, "And Americans will not care what army a man has served in as long as he is willing to serve in the American army if the time should come." Now Paul glanced at Jadwiga's brothers, who were doing little to hide their awkward feelings. "Papa," Jadwiga continued, "in America, we will be judged by American matters. By other Poles in America, you will be judged, Jadwiga, by how Polish you are." This was plainly intended as much for Paul as for Jadwiga. "Even there, Poles will have bad feeling for those who divided Poland." Paul finally spoke. He labored to be polite, trying without success to smile. In his voice, there was poorly concealed anger as he addressed the elder of Dovjak. "What would you have me say?" he asked. Jadwiga's father stopped eating and looked at him. "Would you have me say I denounce all Germans and Bismarck too? Am I to forget the discipline and strength I was given in my compulsory service? Yes, I am Polish. I have the good tastes of a Polish mouth, but I don't hate everything German. I take the good, I reject the bad. I tell you again that I did not bring them here, and as much as I might wish for Poland to be united and free again, those days were gone long before I was born, and I can't change it back." He paused to take a breath. All eating had stopped. "My hating the Germans wouldn't change it back. The good I learned from them I will have in my heart and my mind forever, and I couldn't change it if I wanted to. But I am Polish. As much as any Pole, I would have my country free of the outsiders. But I have made my peace with a bad situation." As Paul stopped speaking, eyes shifted to the older man. "You are Polish?" Edmund Dowiak said. It was not really a question. "Yes, I am Polish. Yet you teach Polish children to march to a German tongue." "Marching is marching. The commands are what I know. It was play for them." "The games children play become the beliefs they defend when they are grown." "They are not damaged. If they learn to march to German commands and the day comes when they must march against the Prussians, the better they will know their enemy. And would you march against them, Paul? Could we win? Would you march against them?" "To win, yes. Not to lose and be enslaved all the more. But to win, Polish men must learn what the Germans know of militarism and combat. We defeat only the enemy we know." "They are the enemy. They are the enemy of all the Polish people while they hold our land for themselves, but they cannot hold our hearts as they held me in military service." "They are your enemy. They rule us. They are the enemy. We all must make our accommodation until better times come to Poland."